Welcome. Please stand and join me for the presentation of colors and the singing of the national anthem. Thank you, and please be seated. Thank you to the University of Utah's Joint ROTC Color Guard, which is in our college, and for performing the and the presentation of colors, and Business Casual University of Utah a cappella for the beautiful performance. I'm Cindy Berg, and as Dean of the College of Social and Behavioral Science, it is a great pleasure to welcome you to a very special day, a day when we get to celebrate the accomplishments of so many of our students and faculty. And we are so pleased that you could be here to celebrate with us. I know that many of you have traveled a very long distance to come and see your daughter or son, your grandson or granddaughter, mother or father or partner graduate. And before we begin, I'd like to introduce Joseph Sargentakis, representing the University of Utah's Board of Trustees. Please stand. Thank you so much for your outstanding service to the university. Also joining me on stage today is Vice President for Institutional Advancement, Heidi Woodbury, and Vice President for Administrative Services, John Nixon, who has a very special graduate, Deanne Nixon, graduating today. Can you both stand? Joining me on stage are the college's outstanding faculty who have served as important teachers, mentors, leaders, and advocates for our students. These faculty members have read an amazing number of papers, exams, students, masters, and dissertation theses many, many, many times. Faculty, please stand and accept our appreciation for all of your dedication. Thank you. To get to this day is no small feat. For those who are graduating with a master's degree, you worked in a laboratory for two or more years with a faculty member. You designed and conducted a study, analyzed your data, and wrote it up, and or you engaged in an intensive course of study culminating in a capstone project. For our PhD students, you've spent a daunting number of hours reading the literature, recruiting participants, doing field work all over the world, analyzing your data, writing your prelims and your dissertation, teaching undergraduates, and serving on committees. I don't know about you, but I'm getting tired just recounting all that you've accomplished. And for many of you, you persevered at times when your motivation waned, when participants were really hard to find, when the field was altered by snow, ice, fire, or maybe even insects, or the data didn't turn out just quite right. And through all of this, you've had the support and encouragement from the faculty who are sitting here on stage, as well as the family members and friends who are in the audience, who I'm sure are anxious to help you celebrate throughout the day and the weekend. If you're a family member, friend, or faculty member who has supported one of the graduates that is graduating today, please stand so that your graduates can formally recognize you. Thank you. Today, the college is awarding over 200 graduate degrees, and this is a very talented group, and I want to highlight only some of their amazing accomplishments. Our college prides itself in finding solutions to some of the world's most challenging and pressing social and natural world challenges. And I can't give you a sense of all of their dissertations or theses, although you'll hear a little bit about those titles of the dissertations. But let me give you just a sampling of the incredible work that our master's and PhD students have done. Two students in our Master's of International Affairs and Global Enterprise program have been awarded the prestigious Fulbright Award. Christopher Rigby, if you could stand. Christopher will be going to Kenya. He will be going to Kenya to implement courses that incentivize Kenyans to communicate more effectively with English-speaking nations. And Brock Mays, Brock, if you could stand. Will be conducting research in Lithuania, doing his capstone project on the impact of Russian influence in campaigns, a kind of timely project right now, including cyber operations. Thank you. Economics student Ali Jalali focused his dissertation on how increases in the minimum wage affect infant health in the United States. He found that infants of women of lower education and income benefit more than higher income women with higher achievement. He's headed off for a postdoctoral fellowship at Cornell Well Medicine in New York City. Ali, can you stand? Nicole Torreson has conducted her dissertation in anthropology, studying gene evolution using data from non-human primates in Mexico and Argentina. She's beginning a postdoctoral fellowship at Rutgers University. Cool. Sarah Turner, a psychology student, examined in her dissertation the important role of sleep in understanding type 1 diabetes management in emerging adulthoods. Not only is sleep a risk factor for college students, as we well know, but it's important in keeping diabetes control. And Sarah is starting this fall a postdoctoral fellow at Primary Children's Hospital. Wendy Davis, a PhD student in political science, conducted her dissertation on how pay for success was a policy that was a catalyst for changes in funding preschool education here in Utah. And finally, Nicole Eberhardt, a sociology student, conducted her dissertation on understanding refugee youth education. During the time of her dissertation, she writes that she was on quite the journey, which she describes as arduous and hard. I'm not sure anyone else would agree with that. But I wanted to read a quote from a note that she wrote, her chair, Ming Wen, as I think it nicely describes the PhD journey. She writes, "Collectively, we've made this journey. It's been transformative. I've sat at the feet of some of the best academics in the game and learned lessons from them, lessons around academics, but also lessons on life. Here we are, and those letters, PhD, the letters, they represent so much more." Aren't our students doing incredible work? Delivering our faculty remarks this year is Dr. Elizabeth Cashdan, professor of anthropology, who received the college's Superior Research Award this year. Dr. Cashdan's research focuses on evolutionary ecology and evolutionary psychology and has really been at the forefront of interdisciplinary research, again, something that the college prides itself in doing. The major themes of her research are how ecology affects human space use and also sex differences in spatial cognition, taking her to faraway places such as northern Botswana. She's published many peer-reviewed articles, has been cited over 3,700 times, with support from the National Science Foundation. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Elizabeth Cashdan.
Thank you, Dean Berg, for this honor and for the invitation to speak to our new graduates. Congratulations to all of you. The Department of Anthropology and the college have both supported me in many ways. One of those ways that Dean Berg alluded to is the freedom to work across disciplines. Disciplines are old. My own discipline of anthropology is a comparatively young field. It's over 100 years old. And so it's inevitable that new questions are going to cross old disciplinary boundaries and that some of our most exciting intellectual sparks are going to fly when ideas and methods and data from different fields find each other. So I want to encourage all of you in that direction. And now that you're an expert in your own field, I hope you're also going to read and listen to and collaborate with people in other fields. One of my own interdisciplinary collaborators over the past few years was last year's winner of this very award, the cognitive psychologist Sarah Creamer-Gare. And so I asked Sarah, "What did you talk about in your speech?" And she said, "I told them to collaborate with people who know different things than they do." It's worked really well for both of us, and I recommend it. I also want to talk to you a bit about what to do when things go wrong, because things inevitably will. One of those problems, again, Dean Berg alluded to this in her opening remarks, is that doing social science is just really hard. It's hard to measure the kinds of things we study. There are too many variables that matter. You can't control them all. And sometimes life just throws a curve at you, and there are unanticipated problems that require a major change of plans. And so what I want to tell you is that if you're flexible, sometimes you can make some really interesting lemonade out of those lemons. My first fieldwork experience was going to be with the famous Kung Bushmen. And, you know, I'd spent months learning the language. I had very specific hypotheses based on the research that my mentors and their mentors had done over decades. But we were stopped before we left the starting gate when the government of Botswana decided, you know, we know everything we need to know about the Kung Bushmen. We think you should work in another area of the country that we don't know very much about. This was really daunting news. We didn't know anything about the people of that new area either. So we found ourselves turning to old explorers' accounts for guidance. But you know, it opened up a new field site, new questions, and I think more original research than I would have had following my original design. So I want to say, be sure to keep an eye open as you go for those side roads and not just the highway in front of you. Another problem many of us faced is investing a lot of time and money testing a great idea and then finding our data telling us no. We've all been there, I think. If you haven't, you will. Thomas Huxley had it right when he said that the great tragedy of science was the slaying of a beautiful hypothesis by an ugly fact. You know, I won't deny it feels like a tragedy in the moment. But it's really good to remember that it only happens if you're a good scholar, because it is so easy to fool yourself. It really takes good scientific methods and data to convince yourself that an idea that you're fond of is wrong. And my own experience is that sometimes I found on the other side of those negative results is a new idea, more interesting than the one I started with. So my final advice to you is stay flexible. If you find out that the gate in front of you is locked, go around and find another way in. Good luck to all of you.
Thank you, Dr. Cashdan, for those great advice. This year's graduate student speech will be delivered by Dr. Lace Padilla. Dr. Padilla finished her Ph.D. from the Cognition and Neuroscience Program in the Department of Psychology. She conducts fascinating research on the way information is displayed and how it affects human behaviors. For example, how it is that trajectories of hurricanes are displaced and whether that affects our evacuation decisions. During her time at the U, she received the University of Utah Graduate Research Fellowship. She's an NSF postdoctoral award at Northwestern University, is in right now negotiating for a faculty position. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Padilla.
Greetings to the dean, faculty, alumni, and class of 2019. As well as a special thanks to all the friends and family that made today possible. While today is a day of celebration, we are graduating in uncertain times. It can seem as if there's uncertainty all around us. We might wake up to news feeds that are filled with information that is uncertain, unsettling, and sometimes downright scary. I should know I'm a cognitive scientist that studies uncertainty. For my PhD, I studied how people around the world utilize uncertain information, such as extreme weather events and climate change data. I've worked with people in places like Haiti and Bangladesh, as well as students here at the University of Utah, to understand what we do when we're presented with uncertainty. And what I've found is revealing. During my 6 years studying this topic, I've learned that when things are going the worst, when it is impossible to understand what the right decision is or what information to trust, people all around the world do the same thing. We turn to each other. You see, people can seem so different from us, but there's so much more that makes us the same than different. And when we're presented with uncertainty, we need one another. And yes, the world may seem uncertain right now, but there's some things that are very certain. Family is certain, community is certain, and love is certain. I'm sure many people have been asking you, what are you going to do when you graduate? And you don't have to know that specifically right now, but you can be certain that the community you've built here at the University of Utah will always be here for you. Because what we have here is special. We are a community of people that is extraordinarily kind to one another. What we've learned is that we are stronger together than apart. We are strong because we are diverse. We are strong because we care for one another, and we are strong because we do not believe the people that want us to distrust one another. Because you see, people profit off of uncertainty. And when we are not united, we are vulnerable. And Utahns are anything but vulnerable. So I encourage you, as you embark into the next stage of your adventure, to take the lessons that you've learned here at the University of Utah out into the world. Teach the world that loving and caring for one another are antidotes to uncertainty. Teach the world the power and strength of a community that cares more about our similarities than our differences. Teach the world that when we work together, we succeed together. And remember, in an uncertain world, love is always certain. Thank you.
What an incredible message for today. Thank you so much. The college and university are proud of the outstanding accomplishments of our faculty, and listed in your program are faculty members who this year received awards at the college level, as well as other university-wide awards this year. And these faculty members were recognized at other celebrations. If you've received one of these awards, please stand and let us show your appreciation for your contributions in research, teaching, and mentoring and service. Most of these awards were presented at other celebrations, but one was not. So Professor Cecilia Wainrib from the Department of Psychology is the recipient of the 2019 Distinguished Teaching Award from the university. Please come forward and receive your award. As a Research One university, the college is committed to giving students an intensive research experience where students can pursue an honors degree. This involves developing a thesis, often collecting data and writing it up in a thesis. And today we wish to recognize Professor Mark Button, who has supervised three or more honors students through their theses within the last 5 years. Professor Button, if you could stand and let us recognize you. I would like to also recognize the distinction of Professor Emeritus. These are faculty members who have been passionate about their profession and dedication to service and have had an impact on the lives of hundreds, sometimes thousands, of students over their careers. Can the newest emeriti professors please stand and be recognized? It's really difficult to imagine that all of these professors will retire as they've been part of our faculty for so many years. And now, the moment that you've been waiting for, the opportunity to recognize and celebrate the conferral of degrees. This is a time-honored tradition in academia. In recognition of the significant achievement of all of our graduates, I'd like to request that all of us remain in the building until the conclusion of the convocation. And we will recognize our graduates as a group, but I know that you're going to recognize them individually as well. Degrees will be conferred first to our doctoral candidates, followed by our students who will be receiving their master's degrees. And we will now begin hooding our doctoral candidates. Names will be read as the candidate steps forward together with the title of their dissertation. Candidates, please have your hood draped over your right arm. As you approach the faculty advisor, there's a step stool here, and you'll see then the advisor will be hooding the doctoral student. And we will begin with Dr. Lace Padilla.
Lace Padilla, Visual Spatial Biases in Ensemble Cognition.
Matthew Hayden, The Trade Effect, Characteristics and Campaign Donations in the Presidential Primaries, 1980 to 2012.
Daniel Elliott Chase, Goodness and Greatness, Abraham Lincoln as a Being Ideal for Public Managers of Conservatorship, an Aristotelian Phronesis.
Richard Amon Jr., the proposition of improving government, investigating shared services in the state of Utah.
Wendy Danley Davis, the politics of policy change, how Utah funded pre-K through pay for success.
Nicole Torreson, Genetic Variations in the TLR7 and TLR8 in Humans and Howlers, Howler Monkeys.
Mm-hmm. Nathan Harris, Independent Selection and Shared Population History.
Sean Miller, Novel Modal Behaviors and the Evolution of the Hominin Brain.
Maria Groves, Climate and Fire Regime Changes on the Colorado Plateau During the Late Holocene.
Emily Nicolosi, Geographies of Grassroots Sustainabilities, Mapping the Places and Spaces of Transition.
Brendan Oslin, Establishing the Psychometric Properties of the Electroencephalogram Spectral Slope, a Non-Invasive Index of Infant Neural Noise.
Sarah Turner, Daily Sleep Quality and Type 1 Diabetes Management in Emerging Adults with Type 1 Diabetes, a Dynamical Systems Examination.
Crosby Madrowski, Risk Factors and Mechanisms Associated with Crossing Over from Child Welfare to the Juvenile Justice System.
Jeremy Grove, Suicide Cognitions and Emotional Responses to a Laboratory Stressor, the Mediating Role of Nightly Subjective Sleep Quality.
Madison Niermeyer, Walking, Talking, and Suppressing, the Effect of Executive Functioning Depletion on Older Adults' Motor Output.
Priya Ramanujam, The Role of the Premonitory Urge in Tic Control, a Behavioral and Neurophysiological Investigation. Erica Barhorst-Cates, Motor Dependence and Spatial Updating, Individual Differences in Age and Movement Experience. Spencer Castrol, Dynamic Workload Modeling for Driving and Conversation.
Oh. Ali Jalali, The Minimum Wage, Income, and Health, Evidence from the U.S.
Dustin Hamalayan, market sentiment, asset prices, and the macroeconomy.
Sakshi Hazuria Anderson, Determinants of Copper Demand, an End-Use Informed Model.
Sophie Wu, Trade Openness, Structural Change, and Productivity Growth.
Nikki Eberhardt, Understanding Refugee Youth Education Incorporation, a Sociological Exploration of Social Capital.
Catherine Mollenhoff, a trans-Holocene, ENSO-driven, lithiofactual change and human response record from Baja California.
Kate McGargle, Subsistence Fires Mediate Human Ecological Relationships.
Great. Please join me in congratulating our newest PhDs of 2019. We are also today conferring a posthumous PhD in political science to Major Brent R. Taylor. Brent was working on his PhD in political science with a focus on international relations when he was killed in action while training an Afghan army battalion in Afghanistan in 2018 on his fourth tour of duty. His interests in public service were extensive, earning his Master's of Public Administration at the University of Utah in 2012 and serving as the mayor of North Ogden. I would now like to present the hood that he would have been presented to his wife, Jenny, and their son, Lincoln. Jenny, if you could come up now. Jenny and the Department of Political Science, as well as the entire college, are raising funds for a scholarship in his name and to honor future leaders like Major Taylor. And you can find more information about that on our website. Thank you all. Now we will confer our master's candidates. So students will come backstage and be directed across the stage. Names will be read as the candidate steps forward.
Mary Jane Campbell.
Robert Lucidus Henry.
Jacob Barton.
Kai Zhang.
Chase William Talbot.
Nicole Prue.
Adrian Sellers.
Sabita Silwa.
Amita Carr.
Chelsea Aykroyd.
Madeline Janine Flynn.
Madison Bear.
Felicia Nicole Sumption.
Hadley Hagee.
Paul Allgaier.
Kelly Nguyen.
Mindy Ann Brown.
Thank you. Jeanette Pack.
Victoria Simmons.
Caitlin Jean Lindsay.
Elizabeth Ann Rendon.
Cassandra Lynn Tello.
Okay, thank you. Sahara Hayes.
Sarah Zemt.
Derek Brenchley.
Brooke Hodson Davies.
Joanna Goss.
Austin Vincent.
Jerry Smith.
Madison Mahone.
Elizabeth Foxley.
Clint Carey.
Georgina Florence Griffith.
Kylie Nicole Hood.
Paula Morden.
Tracy Askins.
Mary Elizabeth Stoddard.
Carmen Valdez.
Sharon Rodriguez.
Kyle Poulter.
Kazra Motaged.
Brock Mays.
Clint Gersh.
Thomas May.
Christopher Rigby.
Sol Jimenez.
Sarah Lotemplio.
Shari Hallen.
Michael Howard.
Jen Colby.
Karen Foltz.
Margo Tello.
John Boyock.
Cagney Smullen.
Jean Marie Kelson.
Ethan Sellers.
Kelly Jones.
Andrea Nagel.
Deanne Nixon.
Jenna Rowland.
Rachel Black.
Blake Perez.
Joseph Mbuga.
Ginger Cannon.
Matthew Proz.
Chrissy Clark Upton.
Jolynn Metro.
Yeah! Alex Peacock.
Laura Madsen.
Do you want us to read them both?
Back to back? Okay.
So we'll read them back to back.
Darlene Candace Bacchus Perucci.
Andy Perucci.
Sydney Grossbeck.
Lacey Johnson.
Richard Smith.
Kara Lynn Baker Toon.
Miranda Jones Cox.
Haley Folger.
Yeah. Brent Packer.
Hey, Danny D.
Eric Hutchings.
Michael Mayer.
Alyssa Sorensen.
Colleen Marshall.
Great. As I think you can tell, we get very attached to our students. So I think they're all back in their seats. If you could now turn that tassel from the right to the left and join me in congratulating all graduates in the class of 2019. I want to thank our musicians, the Utah Pipe Band, and the String Quartet, and all that those have volunteered for Convocation. And special thanks goes to Mary Wong. I don't know where she is, maybe even backstage. But she has had the very large task this year of coordinating all of graduation. So if you're a volunteer, please wave your hand. Mary, wherever you are, please know that we greatly appreciate all that you've done for this Convocation. I also want to thank Professor and Chair Berta Chino and Associate Professor Janine Stefanucci for reading all of those dissertation titles and names. And I want to encourage all of you graduates to take some time today and in the days ahead to really reflect and celebrate on all that you've done. For so many of you, the task has been, what's the next deadline? Where's the next goal? How far behind am I? And I'd really like for you to allow yourself today and in the days ahead to really think through all that you've accomplished. It's a really big deal. And also be in this moment very grateful for those around you, those on the stage, as well as in the audience, for being here with you through that journey. And we all know it is a journey. As Fred Rogers characterizes transitions, often when you think you're at the end of something, you're really at the beginning of something else, and this is just where you're at today. I speak for all the members of the faculty of the College of Social and Behavioral Science as we wish you the very, very best in this next transition. We look forward to continuing our connection with you. Please come back and see us. We love to hear what you're doing, and we've just been honored to be such a tremendous part of your lives. This concludes the convocation, but please remain seated as the stage exits, and right across where the tents are is a lovely celebration for lunch, and we'd love for all of you to join us. Thank you so much.